Lord be with you. Today is the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. Next Sunday, September 12th, is kickoff Sunday. We begin a new program year. Worship will be at 9:30 out in the backyard. There'll be Sunday school and our church picnic. Hope you'll be able to join us. This Tuesday, the Women's Faith Forum begins Tuesday morning, and Tuesday evening, it's the first session in the new year of confirmation. And I remind you that a week from this Saturday, September 18th, is the opportunity to participate in a faith build with Habitat for Humanity. Let's worship God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Trusting in God's promise of forgiveness, let us confess our sin against God and one another. Eternal God, our Creator, in you we live and move and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near you, our refuge and our strength. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we still were sinners, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you know our problems and our weaknesses better than we ourselves. In your love and by your power, help us in our confusion, and in spite of our weakness, make us firm in faith. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from the 35th chapter of Isaiah. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear, here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp. The grass shall become reeds and rushes. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in rulers, nor in any child of earth, for there is no help in them. When they breathe their last, they return to earth, and in that day their thoughts perish. Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the seas, and all that is in them, who keeps his promise forever, who gives justice to those who are oppressed, and food to those who hunger. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord cares for the stranger. He sustains the orphan and widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked. The Lord shall reign forever, your God, O Zion, throughout all generations. Hallelujah.
The second reading is from the second chapter of James. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while to the one who is poor you say, "Stand there," or "Sit at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill," and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith, by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. From there Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying in the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon toward the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then he looked up to heaven, he sighed, and he said to him, "Ephatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The history of Lutherans in the United States could be described as a kind of alphabet soup. Back in 1988, three Lutheran denominations came together to form the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, the ELCA. Those predecessor bodies were the LCA, the ALC, and the AELC. Way back in 1979, I was ordained as a pastor in the LCA, the Lutheran Church in America. I recall a national campaign that was conducted by the LCA to raise funds for outreach and mission. Now, that campaign employed the same three letters, LCA, to give a title to the campaign. The title was Love Compels Action. It was a good theme. It had to be, because I can still recall it all these years later. Love Compels Action is a simple, straightforward message. Love can't flourish as an idea or as an ideal. Love leads to action. Love motivates a person to serve, to care, to be generous, to sacrifice, to risk. Love that just stands still and ventures nothing is really not love at all. In the musical My Fair Lady, Eliza Doolittle grows weary of mere words, and so she sings, "Don't talk of stars burning above. If you're in love, show me. Tell me no dreams filled with desire. If you're on fire, show me. Don't talk of love lasting through time. Make me know undying vow. Show me now. Well, God is love, and God clearly understands how love compels action. God so loved the world that he gave us his only son to die for our salvation. What's true of love is also true of faith. Faith also compels action. That is, faith that does not lead to any good works is really not faithful. It simply consists of empty words. Today, James bluntly reminds us, faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. Using an example from nature, Jesus once said, every good tree bears good fruit. A bad tree cannot bear good fruit. The Holy Spirit blesses us with faith, and faith produces the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, and peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. By their fruits you shall know them, says Jesus. In his letter, James insists that when faith is genuine, the faithful strive to love their neighbors as they love themselves, doing what they can to help them, to serve them, to bless them. James then asks, what good is faith that is not active in love? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? Words without actions are empty. Now then, before St. Paul and Martin Luther start spinning in their graves, I must emphasize, you and I are not saved by our good works, by no means. Nobody gets to heaven by being a good man or woman. As Jesus said, no one is good but God. If we Lutherans know anything, we know we are saved by faith, faith in the grace of God. We are saved by the good works of Jesus and our faith in Jesus. And then as a consequence, because we have been saved, our gratitude and our trust in God's continuing grace lead us to gladly express our faith in good works of love and kindness. In short, good works don't earn us salvation. Instead, good works are the outcome, the product of our salvation. Today's gospel reading offers insight into the kind of work that you and I can be doing. Jesus came to save the whole world, yet so often we see Jesus working one person at a time. In our gospel, Jesus heals the daughter of the Syrophoenician woman and then a deaf mute. He works at ground level with individual persons. Now, of course, Jesus did feed a crowd of 5,000, and he once provided more than enough wine for a large wedding reception. Yet many times we see Jesus working one-on-one. Think of the man he heals who was born blind. Or consider the long conversation he has with a Samaritan woman he meets one-on-one at the community well in the heat of the day. Jesus intercedes on behalf of a woman guilty of adultery and saves her from being stoned to death. Once passing through Jericho, Jesus sees that little tax collector Zacchaeus, a man despised by the whole town, and Jesus asks to have lunch with him. The sisters of Lazarus thought Jesus had arrived too late to save their brother, but we know that Jesus had a miraculous one-on-one encounter with Lazarus, restoring him from death to life. Even on the cross, Jesus reaches out to the thief on the cross next to him and promises him salvation. And then after the resurrection, Jesus has a memorable one-on-one with a very repentant Peter, commissioning Peter to continue the mission and to care for the flock. Jesus comes to save and to love us all, yet we see his saving love in action with specific individuals. Love is like that. Love is never generic or generalized. Love flows from one person to another, like a life-giving blood transfusion. What this says to us is that faith in action often works on a small scale. You and I can work one-on-one, loving one neighbor at a time. Now, certainly, large-scale programs are necessary and good. Disaster relief requires massive resources. World hunger can't be addressed one person at a time. And yet, it is also necessary for each of us to do our small part, one at a time. Habitat for Humanity doesn't build high-rise apartment buildings. Instead, they build one house at a time for one family. If you participate in a habitat build, you can meet individual members of that family and help them to build their permanent home. Refugee One sponsors thousands of families and helps them to get settled here in America. But who will ever forget that one family that we sponsored from the Congo? I can still picture them when they arrived at O'Hare Field, wearing warm coats in the middle of July because they'd heard Chicago was so cold. And then when they first entered their apartment, their shouts and giggles of joy at their new home. School children across the country are in need of guidance and support. Yet working with Waukegan College or North Chicago Community Partners, you can be a mentor or a tutor to one student and change their life for the better. Back in July, we had a guest speaker from Habitat for Humanity describing their work up in Lake County. Members of the family who will eventually live in the house that you and I can help to build also attended that service. It was a very encouraging and hopeful morning. Well, after most everyone had gone home, I walked out to my car, parked out in back, ready to go home and put my feet up. But as I came around the corner of the lot, I saw a very strange sight. There was an African-American man with a big gray afro standing alongside the parking lot, surrounded by a pile of luggage. Now, I have to admit, my first thought was, don't make eye contact. Keep going. This is not my problem. But I just couldn't do that. So I stopped and I asked him what the deal was. Well, the story was never quite clear to me, but somehow a guy at the rooming house where he lives had forced him to leave with all of his stuff and just dropped him off there here at St. James. He said he needed a ride back to Waukegan and he felt that he would be able to get back into his place. So I called Susan, said I wouldn't be home for a while, and loaded the stuff into my car. Then as we drove to Waukegan, I learned that the man was originally from Trinidad, that he had worked as a teacher's aide, but had been coping with several health issues for the past couple years. Long story short, I got him back home, and I wished him well. Now, that trip was not on my list of things to do that Sunday, but I was able to provide the help that he needed. It certainly didn't change the world, but I did what I could, and he was very grateful. Helping each other one at a time, often in very small ways, it's what you and I can do. After all, why else are we here? Amen. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Holy One, you bring your people together in worship. Enliven your church, guide all evangelists, preachers, prophets, and missionaries who seek to share your love through word and deed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You provide water for thirsty ground and sunshine to feed hungry plants. Bless all who advocate for healthy forests, unpolluted air, and clean waterways. Inspire all people to show care for the world you have made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You show no partiality. Increase justice in all nations. Encourage leaders and governments to work with one another for the good of our common world. Especially as we celebrate Labor Day, unite us in seeking the health, safety, and dignity of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You accompany those who are most in need. Shelter all fleeing violence or persecution. Protect any who are in danger, and sustain them through uncertain and unstable times. Help those who suffer, especially those we name aloud or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You support the work of your disciples. Continue to nurture the leadership and the ministries of this congregation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for fellow members Liz Baring, Faye Holm, and Ruth Schnell. We thank you for them, and we ask your blessing on them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You embrace all who have died in the faith and brought them into your glorious presence. We thank you for their example and rejoice in their lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace to follow Christ, make disciples, and live the gospel. Thanks be to God.